So cache and persistence, how it is works, today we just going to be discussing. So persistence is a storage layer inside, it will come with multiple persistence. So cache is nothing but it is called as memory only caches. Yeah, suppose you want to try some data and that should be stored in memory itself, then you can use the cache, this is the alias name for memory only operation. All other thing will come to persistence. And persistence, memory, and disk only, memory only, and memory only serialized disk only serialized. So like that 8 persistence is available. Just only you need to use this keyword to implement, that's it. Okay. Once it is started, I will show you that. So cache, you can directly use as a df.cache and you can implement it. Okay, so what will happen if suppose you, wherever you're going to mention the cache, that output, right, whenever that pipeline will be transferred, it will be following that particular the transformation and it will be create a checkpoint to store that particular output into the memory itself. So simple, understand what I'm saying. If suppose I have a data, I want to process the data. This is a data set I have, 10 GB of data I have. This 10 GB data, I just want to process it. I want to some filter. And then second transformation, what I'm going to do, I'm going to apply some window. And third transformation, I'm going to group the data. Something I'm going to do it. And fourth transformation, I'm going to join it. And fifth transformation, again, I'm going to filter it, something. Sixth transformation, only I will be take that head to the top values. So this many operation I'm going to do it. This is a transformation 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But in another one scenario, same data set, I'm going to do the same transformation, but the output I want to do a different way, I want to filter it. After the joins is completed, I want to take a different region based, another one column based filter. So this is the column one filter. This is column two filter I'm going to apply. Something, this criteria I'm going to happen in that my swap jobs. So what will happen? Again, I'm going to pause another one action. Here one action, I'm going to pause it. Here another one action, I want to pause it. So this is the action one, this is the action two. So in this case, repeatedly, I'm going to use it. Then again, the action two is going to be read the data entirely from the beginning. So what will happen? Action one, I'm going to pause it. It's going to read the data and follow the entire DAG pipeline and provide the output. This is the one way it's completed. Second time, action two, I'm going to pause it, collect or show something, I'm going to pause it. Again, this is the data, the entail is going to be read and then the action two is going to be started. So this take 10 minutes of time. This is take 10 minutes of time, example I'm saying, okay? But total it is called, it will be taking for 20 minutes of time. So we want to avoid that. Instead of this 20 minutes of time, we want to store this intermediate caches, right? This output we have to store somewhere. Whenever I need action two, is going to be referred from here. Whenever like same like action one and action two both. This is going to be referred from the joints itself and then it will be started. So the entire operation will be taking 8 minutes. After the join, this will be take only 2 minutes. This action two is only going to be take for 1 minute something. We just consider. So maximum time to this process will be taking from instead of 20 minutes to 11 minutes. Because here the memory caches I just created, that intermediate output I will store into the RAM itself. Okay, or disk itself. Somewhere I can store it, this intermediate cache output. Like that, my process, I can use it and performance-wise, I can improve very faster. That is the use of this storage layer persistence. We persist the output in somewhere for the intermediate timing. Once that all the action is over, we can release the data. That is called as a persistence. persistent, unpersistent, something they will be mentioned. You're getting me point? Shall we go and see with some example?
Yeah, we can see.
Any question in this? This is majorly you'll be using in real time. Was there any question?
No question, Dinesh. Can you please show these things practically?
Yeah, we can see that. It just takes some time this minute. System is just starting. Okay, so I'm just going to start by Spark. Thank you. Okay, so just started. Okay, we can see with some data frame data. Okay, so some of the records will be stored. This is the first one. Okay, what I'm going to do, I'm going to create a data frame, spark.read.pocket. And then I just deploy the directory. Okay, so data successfully created. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to set partition size. Partition into 500 edges increased. So DF1 directly I just increase the partition size. And then what I'm going to do, DF2, I'm going to okay, data, and then you can apply some group by. DF3 equal to DF2 dot alter custom state equal to Texas one, we just filter it because it's a group by, so state based we can see the data. So same, I'm going to take it out here. DFbox equal to TX. Counting the values. And DF4 equal to the DF3 dot order by. Data we can take to the game. Okay, so this many process we are going to do. So at the end of DF4, I'm going to show the output. So it's just trying to read the data. Okay, so 635 records is available in custom state. That only we just trying to filter it. Again, I'm going to show the data, same action. Okay, we can use a different action. So instead of show, I'm going to use first something, I'm going to use it. So again, it's going to start the entire repartitions and all the process from the beginning, and it takes some time. Okay, so some of the record is going to be read entirely and then it will be showing. Again, I'm going to run it the first statement. It's you can see. Again, it's going to be read the entire data from the beginning. That will be showing the output to you. Right? Again, show I'm going to execute. Okay, it takes at least a minimum 5 seconds. For example, I'm saying now what I'm going to do before the filter, I have a data DF2 data, right? And here I'm going to apply DF2 caches. Okay, now I'm going to run it DF4.show. The first time. You just consider the job is submitted with the cache right now. It is start and read the data. So same, I'm going to execute again. That's it. Again, I'm going to execute again. Only filter operation is going to be processed. Now let me check with the show comments. Sorry, first comments. You can see that 500 partitions of operation is not running. Only 200 partitions of operation is going on right now because we have cached the data. Clear? Are you understand how it is working this? Any question on this? DF show, you suppose I'm going to pass it. You take 200 partitions only. DF first, I'm going to pause it. Only it takes 200 partitions. So suppose you want that, you want to avoid it, you can do DF4, you can cache it. This is a first level process. That's it. I'm going to pause with the show. That's it. So where you are going to apply the transformation of caches, there it's going to be processed. Now you can see no operation is going on. Immediate outcome you can see. Right? Clear, guys? Any question at this point?
There's no question, Dinesh. So basically, it will only help, you know, if our consistency of the filter is same, right?
No, it is a pipeline, right? Entire the pipeline we have mentioned here. So where you are going to cache it, this output you want to cache it, or this output you want to cache it, based on that you just cache the output and store in the memory itself or disk somewhere you can store it. So depends on data's.
Yes, I mean absolutely, yeah. So that's what I'm saying. So let's say, you know, for batch processing or something, like if every day the same batch is going to run and same filter is going to apply, only at that time like we could able to add this kind of cache, right? So
exactly, data is different but actions multiple. Then you can apply this kind of operation to avoid the multiple actions to take more time. If suppose a single action you don't want to pass caches, if you have multiple actions on same data, then you can use the cache and store the data in somewhere and you can retrieve it immediately. That's it.
Yeah, and okay. And if it's like, so it's basically what I'm saying is, let's say today my batch is going to run with multiple transformations. Okay. And tomorrow, the same transformation with the multiple batch with a different, I mean, the more data sets, basically more data, which will be running. Okay. So at that time only will be like, if you add this cache option, but the transformation would be same. So that is going to help us, right? Scheduling of the batch processing.
It's a little clear, understand, you must need here. The transformation is the same, okay, no problem. Data set is varied, that is okay, that's not a problem. If multiple actions on the same data frames, that particular transformation is done, and then you're going to use multiple action, there only you can use caches. It's not depends with your data set or that particular that transformations. How many actions based on the, you have to select your cache persistent storages. Okay. Please be clear on that point. Got it? Are there any question? Cash and persistence belongs to actions, not for transformations. How many actions you're going to pass it, based on that you can select your caches. Okay. Okay, so next we can see one of the with the disk processing, how it is happening. Then we can go next.